Australia's longest war is drawing to a close. Most of our troops in Afghanistan will return home by Christmas. Our forces have achieved so much but paid a hefty price over the past 12 years. So has it been worth it? In a moment, I'll speak to a former soldier who has served in Iraq and Afghanistan to find out what our troops themselves think. But first, Adam Todd has this report.
They are the modern-day faces of bravery, the 39 Australian soldiers who've lost their lives on the battleground in Afghanistan, Australia's longest war.
Yes, we've been there for over a decade, and that's far too long.
Merry Christmas!
Today, news most of our troops will be home by Christmas.
By the end of the year, we will see at least 1,000 Australian personnel return home.
Australia's main base at Tarin Kot will be shut down. Our forces gradually removing 1,300 armoured accommodation blocks, 600 shipping containers and 275 vehicles. And as they pack up, the question is, has Australia's 12-year commitment been worth it? Worth the loss of life? Worth the hundreds of injuries?
It's an impossible question to answer. If there's some kind of way of saying X number of casualties equals success, Y number of casualties equals failure, there's not.
Our troops have overseen significant achievements.
The security in Orisgon is in a much better state than when we first arrived.
And much has been learned.
That it was a very good idea, poorly executed.
What does Afghanistan show? Easiest thing in the world to get in, hardest thing in the world to get out.
A few hundred Australian troops will remain next year, helping international forces hand over control of the country to the Afghan government. But that's unlikely to be the end.
The international community is not walking out at the end of 2014.
Australia is already offering to provide a special forces contingent for counter-terrorism and training purposes, meaning we're likely to retain a presence in the war-torn country for years to come.
Joining me now is former Australian Army officer and military fellow at the Lowy Institute, James Brown. James, welcome. Thanks for joining us tonight. Your background, you spent, of course, some time in Afghanistan in 2008 and 2009. I wonder whether you can give us a bit of a sense, James, what it's like for troops there on the ground, particularly when it comes to the conviction for this cause.
Look, Matt, when I left in 2009, the surge in Afghanistan was just beginning. Thousands of troops were being brought in from America. In places like Kandahar Air Force Base, tons of equipment was being stockpiled, so there was a lot of enthusiasm for taking the fight to the Taliban, particularly in southern Afghanistan. Now we're at the other end of that cycle and we're facing the fact that Australian troops will leave at the end of the year, bring their equipment home and leave Orisgan to the Afghans.
We look at the toll here, if you like, 39 deaths in a decade, hundreds of soldiers wounded and injured. There's been a growing sense, I guess, that as a nation we've just sacrificed too much there. The big question now as we look back is, has this all been worth it?
Well, look, Afghanistan was a state where terrorists could have a passport, where they could get into the international system pretty easily and amass tons of profit safely in the valleys of southern Afghanistan. So we didn't have a choice but to respond. There's been a lot of progress in Afghanistan, but all of that progress is reversible and it's very fragile. One of my colleagues mentioned to me that when he went to Kandahar in 2001, it was a sea of grey. Now at least there's a little bit more colour, women can go to school, so we have changed things, but I don't think we got quite as much progress as we expected.
You mentioned there, pivotal to all of this at the start was, you know, moves to try to deny the Taliban or Al-Qaeda a safe haven. Do you think with withdrawal pending now that there's the risk that the Taliban might regroup?
Look, the Taliban will regroup in southern Afghanistan. They will take over some of the valleys that we've been working in. Al-Qaeda are not really a threat in that area anymore, and we'll keep a pretty good watching brief on southern Afghanistan for the re-emergence of Al-Qaeda. But the strength of the Taliban in southern Afghanistan will really depend on what the Afghan security forces are able to do and how much they want to take the fight to the enemy.
James, when we pause and look at the legacy here, Australia's legacy and the role in the war in Afghanistan, some people say it's a little bit blurry to see what we've achieved. Do you think that we will leave the Uruzgan province a safer place than when we entered?
Yeah, look, we've made progress there. It's safer now than it was when we first went in. It's not as safe as we expected to be. I think after the first couple of years in Afghanistan, we thought we were going to make it a functioning Western democracy. That clearly hasn't happened and may never happen. But there's a spark of education. There are roads that get people to markets. So it's a different place now because of the work that our soldiers and diplomats have done.
For 1,000 Australian families, this will be a particularly special Christmas, won't it? Can you give us a sense of what it will be like for those troops coming home finally at the end of this year?
Look, some of the last troops home will be my former colleagues based in Darwin. They'll get home in time for the build-up, so it may not be the welcome they're looking for. But it's going to be tough for them to reintegrate into normal life. We've got thousands of soldiers now who've lived in Afghanistan and Iraq over the last decade. And I think the best thing we can do is appreciate what they've done, understand it, and be prepared to help them out, particularly with issues like PTSD when they return.
Absolutely. It'll be a big, big challenge. And I think as a nation, we are beyond grateful. Thanks very much for your time tonight, James.
No problem at all, Matt.